Hello everyone, Master01001 here, and in this video I wanted to go over the process I used in modeling this particular handheld based off of the style of Edon Garazu. This is an extension, of course, based on my previous time lapse showing modeling the asset one particular way. This video I want to focus on modeling the asset a slightly different way. I go through, of course, the modeling process, blocking it in, beveling, managing subdivisions even with blends, as well as setting up some basic materials and getting it to render into EV look dev mode. However, at the end of the video I started having some issues with my mouse. However, it looks like I might have been able to get around it just by just blowing into it. So without further ado, let's go ahead and begin. Alright, so getting started, we're gonna first locate the front and then flatten our cube. We'll apply to scale, go in edit mode, select these two edges, and put a bevel in about 10 segments will do. I'm gonna snap my cursor here, and then put a 12 vert circle, RX, RZ, and we just wanna get our circle head on. We'll extrude, scale it in. We'll select both of these and use the hard op shrink to option here to shrink wrap it on. And we see it just works out perfect. We're gonna go into helper and change it to project. And we're gonna project on the X axis negatively. And everything's looking good so far. So we'll put a loop in here and then bevel it to span it out, giving us this area that we'll be working with. Also, we'll go from here to here, holding control P separate. Actually, might have made a mistake there. Let's first control A. We'll apply everything with the control A option, and then we'll go here and spread that out. Split that into a new object. We'll join these together and put one edge loop here, and let's just fill this in. So a little pre-planning can actually make this a lot easier. Right here I'm going to use the mirror with bisect because I want to split this in half and only do a portion of the work. And we'll put one loop here and then terminate it immediately. Actually, let's get rid of that one. Perfect. So, just to make sure we didn't do any long-term damage, let's take this in local mode and we will set smooth. And then we'll put a layer of sub D on it, also S sharpen. And so far, so good. A little planning could have actually made this work out better. In previous examples, I actually ensured that it was exactly 12 in order to take the 12. So you can see it just gets a little bit more hairy if you do not. However, after modeling this thing about 8 or 9 times now, I could say that each time I learned something new. And this one will show that. So we'll mark these as sharp. And from here, I'm gonna add my old buddy bevel. However, we're gonna use the control tilde helper and just set it to weight, because we need weight. And so far, so good. We've got our hole in there. So for the bottom, I actually mirrored it to the bottom previously. However, I didn't like the result of that. So I'm just gonna Shift D, bring it down, Control M, Z, or SZ -1, and then Shift N to flip the normals. So sometimes Blender has the Control M hotkey, but sometimes it doesn't. It's kind of strange. So we'll go with snapping being on, and we'll press G, Z, and hold control to get this piece here. And at this point, we want to separate the selection so that we can apply the mirror and bring it over here. And before we begin inserting this piece in here, we may want to do something like that. And let's see what this looks like as far as supporting us. So make a cut here to isolate. Then we'll just move this over. SY0. We'll select this face, all the way to this face, deleted, leaving us only this face here in the back, which we'll also delete. So we'll join these together. For some reason, people are just always yelling outside the door. Right here, we'll mark sharp, and here's our first little segment piece. If we look at it, the shading looks great, and that's the goal, that's the purpose of the study, is that, you know, I could have used booleans, I could have used box cutter, but in the end, this is the result that I would have wanted, and using the power of sub D, we might as well let it work to our advantage. Keep in mind that at this point we have mirror, subdivision, and bevel, only those three modifiers. So from here, we're going to just add an array on the Y. Scroll it a couple of times. If you press the axis, it will automatically put it to 1, allowing us to real quickly make something like this. Also receiving messages. Okay. We will delete these faces, we don't need it. We'll select this edge loop, which for some reason now is double click instead of alt double clicking. I'm telling you, I think I'm losing my mind. 2.8 just changes sometimes. So from here, we're gonna shift A, bring in a plane. And there's a lot of different ways I was doing this before, but this way I like the most. So we're just deleting a vert and then using Control Shift B to bevel this one. And we're just gonna take our object and convert to curve. We'll select this, select our curve, and press Control P, which brings up the parent menu. And if you're parenting things like this, you'll have an option like curve deform. So now we're deforming it to the curve. So we move it down to Y, we can choose, you know, how bigger handle is right here, but also we want to maybe, I'm thinking we'll end it here, maybe even one short, no, we'll go here, and then we'll slice it there, and we'll get rid of that, that, and these two. And the way that we'll do that is, I've noticed that if you have the curve at the top of your stack, well, first, we're gonna have to make some decisions. Let's apply subdivision. We don't have to apply that. But the array, we do. So we'll apply that. And now we can actually put the curve at the top of the stack, which unlocks the fourth button. If we click on that, you can actually make it show the modifier in edit mode, which will come in handy for what we're trying to do here. So right here, I'm going to press V, cut all that off, and let's just go here and cut all that off, because in none of my previous examples did I have any distorted circles. So we'll select this, let's try it again. And then shift select this. We'll right click and choose bridge, which isn't present unless we're in edge. we'll choose bridge, and we have our edge loop in between. From here, we're going to roll in some spans with Control R, and there we go, guys. So let's mark this sharp, mark this one sharp, just to maintain our integrity. When it comes to mirroring to the other side, it'll be easy. All we have to do is just mirror it over. But what I do want to do here is dissolve this loop, slide this one here, and we'll press 1 to go into vert, and I'll press W until I'm on the lasso. Press GY because, you know, this isn't real. We're thinking of the unapplied version in terms of modifying this. So we'll move that, grab this loop. It isn't needed anymore. And here we are with the shape more to my liking. So we'll, right here, I use Shift Tilde, and that's because under Select Loops, I love setting Select Boundary Loop to Shift Tilde. So it's something that you should probably try out. But I could just select everything, press Shift Tilde, and it automatically highlights the hole, where I can press F, where I can press Q, set sharp, call it a day. And things are looking pretty good here. I can also press Alt X and put a modifier mirror, not a bisect mirror. At this point, we need the object to remain manifold for Boolean cutting. So at this point, we are just cutting it down the middle with the modifiers. So that way, if we go in edit mode, it's still real, but in object mode, it'll do a nice little merge. Also, this one is a little more rounded than previous ones. Let's take a look at our stack here. We'll collapse everything. We got curve, sub, deep, bevel. I am going to opt to go ahead and apply sub D, but before that, we do want to definitely maintain the planar nature of this face. And the easiest way to do that is with a subdivision crease. So I'm selecting one edge, control clicking in front of it to select everything in between, Q, set sharp, bada bing, bada boom. So we will apply one level of sub D. And things are looking pretty hairy. And that's because in order for the booleans to work right along with the sharpening and the shading, we're just gonna have to break a few eggs. Trying to keep all this stuff non-destructive would just do more harm than good, and in the end, compromise the quality of the model. So under operations, I'm gonna choose clean mesh. However, instead of letting that happen, I'm gonna actually choose selected. So it actually cleans only the selected area. And let's also remark sharp. And I'm just trying to make sure that nothing happened here. So I'm just gonna Shift S, snap my cursor here. Shift S, snap cursor to selected. Where's my cursor? And we'll go here, press period, 3D cursor, SC, 0. Not sure what happened. Okay, it's the original object thing. I forget about that. So at that point, at this point, we can go ahead and apply the curve. We're not going to be modifying the curve anymore. So now it's just mirroring and beveling. In fact, we want to mirror it and then bevel it, just to make the bevel a little bit easier going. Also, I forgot to make the trigger area here, which would have been easier if I would have actually done it one level back. So let's look at how we would do it in our current state. So I'm just going to draw a box, press A. That's not going to work with surface orientation. So I'm going to click this button, which aligns the shape to the view, draw a box, press A, E, create my shape. Okay, I'm in local mode. That's what's also doing me in. We can get rid of that. Shift S, origin to geometry. And also, we don't want to be using the 3D cursor for our origin anymore. And we will just take this, use the hard ops union system to join that together. And let's C sharpen. Good thing is, since we already had the bevel in early, C sharpen's not gonna be this thing that's gonna take over and cause us to have to deal with a whole bunch. It's just us promoting the object, even though we were kind of working in undefined state for the majority of this. However, we did cut a little bit close to the metal. So of course, the more geometry you have, the more likely you are gonna have Boolean issues. So the simpler the object, the funner a time you're definitely gonna have, which is why, you know, when starting out with these tools, it's nice to start with a cube. But as time goes on, you definitely want to move away from that and move on to real world objects, of course, stuff and things, or spaceships or guns. But you know, Box City's just how I wake up in the morning. So using box cutter and snapping dots, I will hold control if it worked. What's going on here? Also, near miss. Anytime there's a near miss, like you know, something like this, this nearly worked out, but that actually works better. You might as well just do a quick little correction on it. However, I don't know why the dots, oh, view align, sorry. These are all gotchas. Once you have view align on, you will no longer have dots showing on the surface. They'll be aligned to the viewport. So just one of those things. Sometimes I forget. So right here, using N-Gon, we're just gonna cut a little piece out. Just a little visual interest. You know me, I love my random extrusions. So far so good. However, the more we cut, the more at risk we're gonna be at finding hotlines and creating shading issues. And so the real art of this exercise is to be able to create a shape that's shaded nicely to begin with, and then from there begin shredding it up and making it into a much more unstable mesh. And you know, this is what I work for. You know, I will retopple a robot, get the topology very nice, very pretty, and then push it one more level. And I love it. So right here, we're just gonna cut pieces out and C-sharp them. This one is gonna cause an issue. However, GG, done. You know, right here, there's an issue, GG, done. You know, I could get in here and get way more intensive with the process, but I just want to show you that it can also be very easy, especially if you just get in there and do it. You don't want to let this sort of stuff stack up because it does compromise the integrity of your mesh. You know, if you have overlapping geometry, that's going to add to Boolean issues down the road. You know, the majority of issues that I see reported with NSET are usually based off of it dealing with geometry that just wouldn't be healthy for it. And it's not the fault of the user, of course. This is due to just the way the inset works. Like, for example, I'm using inset here. However, I'm gonna shift to live to keep it, where you can see that the inset is a slice of the mesh, meaning that the slice going in has the same problems as the mesh itself. So if you have problems with that mesh, they're gonna reflect here. Now, the reason I also kept it live is because I wanna select this one edge and bevel it. However, before I do that, I may wanna slide this one up just a little bit and then grab this edge and just give it a nice bevel. Just enough to almost match the curve. I was also thinking about using a little bit of Moy in this to show as well, because I've been modeling this thing like 8 ways to Sunday. This is Edon's, you know, nothing asset. This is what he makes when he just doesn't feel like making anything. You know, it's of so little effort to him that he can make these things without any sort of thought. It's just design spit. And that kind of got me interested in it, you know, in the shape, the simple shape, the functions, the labeling, the different workflows that can be figured out over the course of making these. Of course, since I'm working very destructively, that means I can get in here and solve these things. So if you're asking, you know, why aren't you able to do this sort of thing destructively, it would be that I could either stack up so many modifiers that makes it more complicated, but really, in some cases, once you get the model right, you know that you want to proceed. I mean, normally I would duplicate this thing on another layer so that way I could take it through an entirely different adventure if I needed to. But in this case, I know I've done this enough that I just know that this is going to be the final one. So someone wrote me asking if I was going to do a video on this. I also got to throw in a note. You don't have to send me emails about non-support issues. A YouTube comment will suffice. Also, I didn't do this because of you. It was already planned. I just wanted to do a couple of videos on this, just showing examinations of the workflow and just different ways it could be approached. Like this one, I didn't use any sort of view alignment magic to get in there specifically. Right here, this exposes a byproduct of box cutter being non-destructive, while also utilizing weight information. In this case, you see that weight information cut into a weighted object will result in the bevels being beveled, which is just one of those nice things you get from the angle. However, you know, you just gotta roll with the punches on this sort of thing. We do have some ideas on possibly applying the shape in the future or something like that prior to making it an option. But for now, it's just something we have to live with. And anyone would, dealing with beveling individual edges in a non-destructive fashion. So we'll just do a little trench cut here, sharpen that. So far, so good. So you see that these shapes, for me, it's just creating a little hoop. The hoop is there's such a crucial angle. I spent a bit of time trying to understand that. So this is a slice, but I'm holding shift because it's also a dynamic slice. And we're going to select this edge and bevel it. And I have other videos I've been meaning to do. In fact, you know, the last robot I was working on was actually, you know, let's undo. Undo is crazy, you guys. You know, I just want to throw that out there. You know, we're talking about it internally on ways to fix the undo, I mean, or at least ways to improve upon it remaining stable, because every time, you know, I undo, I hold my breath. I'm like, is this it? Is this the moment I meet my maker? Well, my desktop's not my maker, but you get the idea. Is this where I just get taken completely out the game? Like a Linkin Park song. So we'll do a cut here. Last and dissolve. So these issues that you see that come up, the art of solving them, I cannot stress how important it is. Because at some point you're going to want to break some eggs. Like right here, you know, I'm just going to not cut so close. In fact, let's turn on wireframe for just a moment so that we can cut with care. There's just some loops I don't want to mess with. And that one's one of them. However, I damn sure don't want this thing beveling a planar edge all the way across my model, because that would be crazy in itself. We'll press Alt V, turn wireframe back off, and continue working. So one good cut always deserves another, you know me. So I will cut here. Oh God, made a mistake. Let's try it again. I could have undid as well. I forget that we have undo back in Box Cutter now. And we'll keep it live. So at this point, I actually came up with an idea that I was discussing with the team, like, what'd be cool is if we could tourney cut into a slice, you know, because that's mainly why I T-thick, you know, is because I get to see it as a cut, and then, or why I cut with red and then add solidification, it's because I get to see it as a cut, and then I get to convert it to a slice. Like, notice not the best answer, but it does let me kind of see inside the mesh. It lets me see what I'm taking away and also giving back at the same time, as well as also put a gap in between. However, we also need the ability to create a slice that also adds those sort of gaps. In fact, select here to here, slide that out, done. So it seems like it's a lot, but we've only been here 25 minutes, just having a nice conversation, cutting up this piece right here. No one will stand for this. And this is a part that people like, is having the shading hold together. But you see that as you cut at an angle, it creates these counter lines that you have to fight, this edge flow. And this is truly the battle of hard surface, at least with making stuff like this. I mean, I could have also kept it quad and dealt with subdivision the whole time, but subdivision is a little limiting in my opinion, which is why I'm not using it, because the detail would just require more and more support geometry, and the support geometry that booleans require is just a little bit simpler in my opinion. I can almost give boolean's trash geometry, and as long as I fit their criteria, it's fine, you know, no holes, that's dumb the rules. So, and you can cut with holes, you can cut on planes, which is also a viable workflow. So far so good, things are looking good. I should have scaled this in while it was live, but I did not. Let's see if we Alt S it. And no, too much strange normal behavior going on there. So instead, let's Alt V, look at the wireframe again, because we don't wanna, damn it. All right, that was kind of weird, but we're back up in the club and we didn't lose a lot of progress. And we got back a lot for some guys who didn't save. Let me tell you, it's one of those Jesus take the wheel situations. I gotta stop recording tutorials like this. It hurts me. However, we will select this, cut a difference. However, while it's still alive, we'll adjust the thickness to make it not too thick. And we'll also shift select this, difference. And now we can C-sharp to apply this. So far, so good. And the only thing we're really missing is the trigger. And so, believe it or not, triggers used to be a little tougher for me. However, after doing it over and over for these little handhelds of the add-on series, these handhelds are my homage to them. To show my admiration of his design work. He also worked on I Am Mother. Yeah, just watched that movie. We're talking about how much of a mindfuck it was. So, continuing on, I'm just going to extrude, and then we'll put a loop here. go into face mode, inset E, X, Y. And at this point, there's not a single polygon introduced. Let's just talk about this because, you know, I tend to drift in and out of modeling properly and modeling improperly. And it really depends on the level of shading that I'm going for, because while you can definitely get a lot of speed benefits to using booleans, you know, there's also a lot of benefits to having an understanding of vanilla workflows. For example, you know, if you had to assign a lattice to an object, most people would probably add a lattice modifier and then populate the field with the lattice, which is a lot of work. That's like five clicks. Alternatively, you could select the object, select the lattice, control P, lattice to form, work is done. And then at the end, if you need to modify the lattice, you select the object and you Alt P to separate its parent from the lattice. I mean, I should probably do a video explaining that instead of just throwing out concepts. So we put a couple levels of subdivision on here, and if there I was about to add support loops. What was I doing? And also, let's split this mesh in half and not do so much work. And we're already getting somewhere. So just by creasing these edges, of course, for it to crease in the control tilde workflow area, I have it set where marking edges marks everything. It's just been great and I don't regret it at all. So we'll mark that one sharp. We will mark that one sharp. That's just marking the right edges here just to weather some sub D, going for a slightly different trigger than the ones in my previous ones. You know, it's always nice to throw some differences up in all these different attempts. I'm telling you, I've learned a lot. So it's not looking the best, and we're probably going to require some geometry for this transition. However, if we Alt V, look at the wireframe, we see that that's a big addition. So let's talk about this. What do we want to do with this trigger? Let's say we were making it work with sub D. I'm going to press inset, but I'm going to press B. So I use the boundary of the mirror, you know, kind of weird. I love it. So glad Blender has that. We'll select this, 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 and this. Alt S, push that out. And we're just trying to go for some ridges here, which as you can see, it just asks for more and more as it goes on. So how can we do this? Can we crease it? Can we crease these little ridges in here? And also look how dense this geometry is. This thing's probably as dense as the gun. You know, maybe I'll just have a subdivision trigger, you know, just for old time's sake, just show you guys that, you know, this is the way things used to be. And I'm not so far removed from it that I'd never model like this. In fact, you know, I call this by the book, and it's like the first thing that I go to, because you definitely, if I would ever aspire to improve on any of the workflows in Blender, it would definitely be the ones that are already time tested and approved. So we can select that whole loop and we'll hide this face and we'll hide that face, leaving us only this thing for us to select, Shift H. And if you're thinking, wow, this is turning into a kerfuffle. Yeah, a sub D, bro. So just sliding that over. And let's see, what do we got here? You know what, we'll just merge it with this. It doesn't matter if we have tries because they're being turned to quads by the subdivision, even though the tries that we're part giving it in the flow is just not the most optimal. If we press Alt V, we can see that it looks good. Ish, maybe. Actually, maybe not. I probably could have done with a a loop here to protect the boundary. I don't know why I'm so obsessed over this thing now. Let's just dissolve it. Nope. Maybe it's that we need to bring it over. Yep, that's probably it. So in between here, there's just these little circular flows being created. Let's press Alt V so we can see them. Yeah. I mean, I can almost look at geometry and imagine what subdivision would turn it into. Because I've spent a bit of time doing subdivision conversion. So right here, we see that what could help that shape? Sheesh, I didn't want to just go heavy-handed on this thing. You know, just scorched earth. Crease them all. You know, we have a whole handheld to deal with, and I'm sitting here talking about this trigger for so very long. I apologize to you, the viewer. That's where those downvotes come from. Downvotes come from me holding off on the trigger so long. So we'll select both objects, press Alt X, and we'll mirror the trigger across this. And the reason I do that is because I can just move it over on the X and it just makes it smaller. I can pull it back. It just kind of makes everything dynamic. Also, I see that I could probably just modify that flow. And we'll just bring that up. So ta-da, so we lost a hole, but we gained a trigger. So continuing on. So we don't need the curve anymore. I mean, I'm not deleting anything, I'm just hiding it. We'll deal with that later. But back to working on the item in question. C sharpen, of course. Right here, you just want to slide that over, and you don't have any of that, or else we would deal with it. Lower to be with ever so slightly. And right here, we're just going to draw a box. C sharpen. And of course, because of our choices, we have to put a restraining order on that edge. And these two need to be joined in holy matrimony. So, continuing on. Using the power of Ingon, we'll just cut a little piece out here. And I just like making little front plates on these. You don't deserve to be sharp. You know, I should use the sharp manager to fix this. But instead, we'll just deal with it ourselves. So the next thing is we're gonna draw a circle, but we're aligned to the view. J. We'll pull it out one way, bring it back the other. But we'll hold shift to keep it live. Apply because it's just too close. I also want to throw in that if you're needing to make a shape live, like for example, if I want this to be live, I can press L and it changes the color, and no matter what, it's going to make the shape live. But the thing is that after doing that, every shape is live unless you untoggle it because it's a state. Now it's back to being regular, but that's there. In case you were ever seeing in the previous videos where I mentioned wanting it, now we have it. So right here, random extrusions, all rights reserved, copyright Master Xeon, 2018. What year is this? So continuing on, just little cuts, little doohickeys. Of course, to make such a small cut, sacrifices must be made. All right, there we go. We've created our piece here. However, we do need to draw a box and cut it short. It showed so much promise, but it was just getting out there, you guys. So I'm gonna select this face, duplicate it, P, separate, select this face. We're gonna inset it. I have to press I twice sometimes. You know, don't ask. But it throws me off every time. I'm like, what's going on with the inset? It's like inset's not having a problem. Something has changed with it. So I'm gonna delete these two verts so that way I can select what I'm ripping and get rid of it. And I'll turn on vertices snapping so I can press GZ, hold control, and snap to that vert. And we're just going to add solidification to this and as sharpen, not gonna work. And that's because this is just a strip. Something has gone wrong. There we go. Modifier order restored. We'll bring it back. And I'm just gonna control A. Actually, I was about to make a terrible mistake. We're just gonna apply those mods through our stack. I was actually about to apply everything, but you never apply to bevel. I mean, not that type of bevel, not unless it's a bevel that's helping build up the form. There's no need to ever apply the little detail bevel. It's what I refer to it as nowadays. But you don't want to apply that. It would just add too much geometry. It's not necessary. It's easier. Keep it dynamic. Turn that off. I mean, the model that you would have it on anyways would be the quote-unquote final one as it is. So here we are. We've added our little foil. If we wanted to, we could put it up top too. In fact, if I wanted to do that, because the origins are all based on the same freaking object, I would have to, I try to snap my cursor to this, didn't even put it in the center. And I can't select any midpoints because none of them truly exist. So what I'll need to do is symmetrize the object. And now because the object is truly symmetrized, I can snap my cursor there. I can shift A, add an empty of a sphere, right click to modify the size, and we'll select this, select the empty, Alt X, Z. So good, so far. However, we need more control than that. So let's try this again. We will remove the mirror. This time we'll add an array. Object offset. Empty 002. Shift S. Origins to geometry, and we want no offset, and ideally this should work, where now this is almost like a instance. So maybe not the greatest idea, but it will definitely work for our needs. And we're not done yet. I haven't even saved the file yet, so who knows, maybe I am done. You know, Blender will just be done with me, and then I'm done, you know. So, always save your file. Don't be like me. This is literally me pressure testing. You know, I actually was recording a video previously, and it fell into the same circumstance where Blender ended up crashing when my girlfriend interrupted me, which ended my video. So one day I might do like a B-sides someday where I just put out all the unreleased content, because there's a lot. Sometimes, you know, it just doesn't end the way I like. And because I have haters, you know, I can't be feeding them fuel, showing that I'm a loser. You know, otherwise I'd be showing y'all how I'd be getting my ass whooped in Sekiro. So right here, we're gonna symmetrize it down the middle. And that is so we can use edge snapping to grab this hot edge and make a cylinder. And then we will select the skeleton. We'll put loop here, put a loop here. We'll put a bunch of loops here. Press Control B, E, Alt S, and call it a day. I mean, we could have done this not instructively, used some lathes, talked about it for 24 minutes, done a very long video about it, but it's such a basic part of this thing. It means nothing. So let's move past it. Also, I saw a shading issue here. Where is it? It looks crazy from afar. Who's doing that? All right, maybe I'm hallucinating. Sorry, you guys. So one of the things I do like to cut into these is my signature MX grill pattern. So we'll draw a shape like that. And we'll pull it in slightly. However, I think we have a straight edge. Nope, looks fine. Like, I know there's a bit of eyeballing going on here. I do understand the need of precision tools. However, you know, all these things are added to a list. Someday. Like I always say, a lot of these things require other things to happen in order to make it happen. So we're just gonna grab that, bring it in. And we're just gonna drag a box, hold shift, keep that box live, and we're just gonna duplicate it. And all I did here was cut the cutter, which if you're not cutting the cutters, cut the cutters, you guys. You could find such crazy shapes in the cutter. And I just undid there. You know, I could have ended all life on planet Earth at that moment. But luckily, Blender stayed open. So we're just moving this edge ever so slightly, still eyeballing. And C sharp. And now that has been added to this. And you know, another interesting shape would be something like that. And then round it, but we're gonna shift it to live. We're gonna apply the geometry. I'm gonna remove these dang sharp markings because they just help nobody. I mean, they help us in box cutter, but when it comes to the hop side in the weight workflow, wreak some havoc. So we're just gonna put one there, put one here. I probably should have kept it non-destructive for reuse, or at least duplicated it so I could reuse it. But I think we're getting somewhere here. In fact, this model is just about done. So the next thing is the hose. In the previous video, I did a hose and it came out just terrible. I was like, sheesh. Video makes me look like an idiot. So we're going to take the circle, line it to view, and I'm going to show you the way I do spiral hoses now. And we're just going to, and I offset the circle from here. If I was someone else, I would use this place and all of that, but who cares if this is non-destructive? I already know what I want. And we'll coil it up. And we'll apply that. And we're just gonna bring down the screw heavily. I learned this previously. And we're gonna apply that. And you're like, hey, why'd you apply that screw that looks terrible? Well, we're gonna select one lucky loop, separate it from its family, giving us this. The greatest spring ever. The spring cell collection. However, you know, think about these spirals. It's so confusing to see which vert is which. You gotta, you know, look at it just right angle. As you can tell, I'm a man easily confused by illusions. You know, that's why I don't let magicians hang out. They'll trick me. Literally saw me in half without any trick involved. So Control Shift B, roll the wheel. And there we go. We're gonna apply a level of subdivision on it, which we didn't even apply it. Control A, geometry to mesh. Now it's applied. But we don't even want to do that. We want to convert to a curve so that now whenever we inflate it, it's just perfect. We press S during a test curve to set smooth, a classic. And this is our handheld. And this was way easier than the previous attempts. In fact, I still may do one showing how I did it previously, because it's the goal is to show view align type working with it and how it is in Blender, because it's changed from 7.9. It used to be, I mean, it was never straightforward, but it's still around in a capacity. It's like the thing with the timeline and setting markers. You know, it's kind of weird with the timeline now because of 2.8 conventions, but still good that they didn't take markers out. You know, I was watching Blender today. I saw people in the chat talking about, are they going to add the Blender game engine to 2.8? You guys are crazy. What are y'all going to do with that thing? Just have fun, just some experiments. But yeah, I don't think Blender's ever gonna put that game engine back. All right, and we'll duplicate just one more, put it here, just because it's a hole, it needs a solution. So with our hose here, let's locate the end of the line. We'll press Control Plus. The reason my keyboard is so loud and annoying is because right now I'm on the NUC. You know, I've been trying to work my way back to the AMD, but there's this thing that happens where it disconnects my speaker, or it disconnects my audio. Also, curve is in the wrong direction, you guys. No one was even gonna tell me. But I have this issue where the audio just cuts out, and it'll disconnect all my USB devices. So, I mean, I could live with losing audio. It's like, fine. It's the part where it disconnects the keyboard and mouse when I'm using Blender that will just make me rage. I mean, I love that computer, but it just doesn't love me. Like, I need to read a manual on how to be an AMD owner. These are things we talk about while we extrude this curve, and we wonder, is this curve being good to us? I mean, we could actually go in the curve properties of the helper, and let's just change that resolution to like 64. Probably won't help. Also, is it me, or does this hose just look strange? There we go. We apply the scale. Now it's looking right. I was like, what's going on with this hose? So we're going to save this as at Study 8. Of course, this will be a model up on Patreon. If you're a Patreon, I'm always giving out stuff and things I'm working on. Pretty agreement. And so I'm glad that people are still hanging on after all this time. It almost keeps me working on stuff to post, because I'm like, sheesh, I gotta please my patrons. You know, these guys, they're waiting for the goods. And I gotta give it to them once a month. So we will scale this in, and we're going to just put a material on this, and we're gonna make it red. Don't tell my friends. They'll make fun of me. They'll be like, Jerry. Jerry's what people call me now. Why you do it? I can't help it. It's my favorite color. So aggressive. So we'll take this, mirror this over, and just take a look at what we have here. If we render this in Eevee, of course, gonna look like a champ. I have a custom shader that I use here, and that's probably what you're seeing is this R shader. However, we're going to actually replace it with a diffuse shader and then replace it with a principal shader so we can get rid of everything that was connected to it. I mean, I've never done that before. I thought of it just now. We'll remove everything that's connected. It didn't even remove everything, so much for that being a trick of the day. However, we lower the roughness and we add to the metallicity, and we just give everything this shader. I mean, it's just a basic shader. People are always like, hey, like your shader. What shader? What is this? It's probably a random cube. Also, the red is just, for a bit I thought something was selected. Also, this one looks like something you would use to gas up an electric vehicle. So we'll select a couple of pieces. We'll call this glass. And making it plastic will just be us getting these values just right. Clear coat. I like to use the clear coat to just bring a little bit of reflection back into this stuff. We'll share that material. Kind of looks a little pearl. So we may adjust that roughness. What do we got here? Also, this material looks so bright. I mean, the color is pretty black. There we go. Alright, so all of these buttons, we'll just remove that shader and click on this button to remind me that clicking on, get out of here, Cortana, to remind me that, first of all, caps lock is on, so I'm saying it very loud, you guys, that the material doesn't automatically assign. It's like a glitch in a new helper. It's not so bad. I mean, I just roll right past it every time, but geez Louise, I hate that thing. But in time, I'm telling you, if it drives me crazy, there's got to be a kibosh put in that thing. So right here, we'll actually give this one a slightly brighter finish, maybe a little more matte. And that's a color that I'll put on the front because I like it. Something like that. I mean, for really the final flare, I could just get up on some decal machine for this thing and it would just look great. Let me tell you, because I mean, the approach with decal machine is I could just model the form, slap these on there, and it would look great, and it would be fake, but it would be great. And the fact that it's fake means that it's even easier to do. So I never mean it in a disparaging way anytime I say that he's the king of fake, because that makes him smarter than any of us. You know, I've been trying to do all this shiznit manually. And it turns out that there's actually a way that you can make it look fake and still get that same result across. So if none of you are trying out decal machine or using it yet, you know, I cannot recommend it enough. Probably one of the greatest Blender plugins of all time. And then for people who liked decal machine, mesh machine. So there's my shout out for this. I may not be using DM on this particular model, just because I'm on the NUC, and all my libraries. I'm trying to figure out a way to get my libraries to sync across everything, because I'm like different computers, different libraries, just strange. So far, so good. However, we could do a little more. And we just might. All right, apply. And we see that both of those cuts were high risk cuts that resulted in security breaches of the surface. So we're gonna need to get in there, send in the mercs, and fix these surfaces in order to proceed, because like I said, if you let that kind of stuff rack up, these surface imperfections, they're gonna result in manifold issues, which will affect your ability to 3D print and do all that sort of stuff. So I'm gonna select this edge and press Shift 1. Or never mind, I guess it's not going to let me. Let's try that again. You know what, I'm just gonna select this edge, bevel it. I was actually trying to align my view to it because I was gonna do a little bit of cutting in this area, but it seems to be working against me. So we'll bring out another cut like so. And we'll just have that terminate just like that. And we're gonna slide this piece down. You know, every time I make one of these, I just get weirder and weirder. Eventually, Edon's gonna not even recognize his own prop anymore. I'm gonna join that so I can dissolve that. You know, I kind of messed up a life to save a life in that case. And then we follow that up with circle, but not all the way through. That'd be a cop out. You wish I would just go all the way through, call it a day. Nope, two circles is required with that, using the power of the control snapping dots. So here we are, we have our object. In fact, I could do with making that just a little darker. And we're looking pretty good. We're also an hour into this video, so that means we'll be wrapping up any second. We'll just call this, you know what, glossy shader. That's the easiest way to simplify this. Actually, let's go back to the principal shader. We see that with the glossy, it's just not going to let us get that plastic look, which is so nice for something like this. You know, not too much roughness, give it a little clear coat. And use that clear coat just to allow it to pick up just enough reflections. We'll bring down the color a tad. Control S. And we still have this empty for a moment. It was distracting me. You know what else is crazy is that, I was gonna say we could select the entire loop around this thing, but nowhere does it loop all the way around. But oh geez, you know what? Let's do it, guys. I'm gonna Shift D, Control A, Visual Geometry to Mesh, go in Edit Mode, and we're gonna try to grab an entire loop. Like that loop. And we'll delete everything else. From here, SY0. And then we'll run something called clean mesh on it, which will get rid of anything that isn't needed. Did not do the best job. However, did a good enough job for us to go under here, convert it to a curve, and adjust a curve. Go back into regular mode out of local, and we're just gonna give this the material, give it some thickness, press 3, set it to the preset of 3, which is just a denser, higher resolution curve. Also received a comment And I want to take this shift D. No, I don't want to do that. Not all ideas are good ones. So to top this off, we'll just put a little stand behind this, just like I did in the previous demo. That way it ends on a good note, because if we're not rendering, I don't consider it a successful video, personally. Eevee just looks too good. It's just too easy to get into. We're gonna fill this face right here. I know this is a crazy shape, and I'm modeling like nonsense, but that's the shape I want. I'm just trying to create this stand of sorts. So we'll inset it, bring it in, maybe not too far in. We'll put a loop across. That loop will let me dissolve that loop. I mean, those areas where I can then bevel this, mirror it over. Of course, use an object. We'll put a C-sharp on it and also give it a material like plastic. There we go. So if you were looking forward to a longer video, this is definitely the video for you. It's like church. G, Y, G, Y, G, Z. S, Y. We're just putting some spans in here to just make it a little more fitting. So shift A, plane, RX, and we'll put this in the back. Right here. And we'll subdivide. Maybe even subdivide. And then poke through the spacebar menu. And then Alt J to convert everything into a quad again. And from here, we're gonna put a modifier called wireframe. And wireframe just comes in handy. Who's messaging me now? All right, message ignored. Back to work. And we'll just lower that wireframe just a little bit more. And here is our model. So with this edge, I'm just gonna demote it. Actually, what's going on here? All right, I was having a hallucination for a second. I was like, wait, did the button not work? That's a level 10 DEFCON situation. Gotta pull all the boys together. All right, so I think this mesh doesn't have the most normal normals. And that's what made it get weird for a second there, in case anyone was wondering. That was the way I built it, you know, just built so strange. But continuing on, we're just doing this by the book, because this is exactly how I did it before I went to bed on a casual test that I was pleased with. All right, look at this from the side. Look at this from normal view. I think I killed Blender. Damn it, I killed Blender. What did I do? What did I click? Also, Oh, I see, I did save it this time. Does Blender even come back from this sort of stuff? That is the question. I'm thinking no, because it would have. No, of course not. The question of what happened that day, we may never know. But what we do know is that autosave put us back right back in time. It's like Prince of Persia with Blender right now. You know, you just fall off a cliff, and then the next thing you know, you're back trying it again. In fact, let's save it and then go into Ngon and try to cut something in. And, you know, to top this thing off truly would be to first give it a little bit more closeness, but also I put some hooks on it. I mean, how's this thing being suspended? That was a conundrum I came to yesterday. I was like, oh, so it came out all right, but I gotta make it have a hook. You know, what's the hook? So we'll put a loop here, delete a loop, bring a loop up, delete this vert, bring that one back, and geez, I think I'm also having a mouse malfunction where the mouse is like triple clicking. It happens all the time. Control shift B, and we see that the bevel doesn't go right because the mesh needs its scale applied. So now control shift B. All right, one, we'll select this one, this, what the hell are you doing, Blender? One, two, merge at center. Yeah, I think I'm definitely having a mouse issue. We'll select this one, control shift B, control shift B. Wow, really hitting the wrong buttons out there. And bring this down right here. Actually, let's bring it down right here. And we'll just use box cutter. With this. Ooh, come on, mouse. I just need you to make it till the end of this video. And also, this shape is mirrored. That's what's going on here. There we go. That's the result I want. In fact, it's not the result I want. There we go, that's the result I want. I want this non-destructive because I'm gonna need to modify it after the fact. Press S. And chrome. And for the chrome, I always like to make the chrome material blue in the viewport, just so I know what's been chrome, what's gonna... Oh my God, my mouse. F in the chat for my mouse, guys. Because I'm about to take it outside and have a office space moment with it. Alright. And we'll duplicate it down this way because everyone should hang their tools up when they're done. And I'm not even gonna finish that joke. Y'all might not have the same sense of humor. So, continuing on. There we go. Layer one. In fact, we look at layer three. It's almost like we can see the shape of our thing that we made with all the cutters we made. So far, so good. Save. This is what we're looking at as far as our Eevee render. So at this point, I'm going to bring in an area light, scale it up, maybe by the book. That way is how you scale it. And we'll add contact shadows. That's how I could tell if I'm having a mouse issue, is it will just stop when I'm dragging, clicking and dragging a field. And let's see, we'll put one here, set to point at this. And I don't have the Control T hotkey anymore from back in the day of track two. So I just use spacebar for everything. I don't know if that's Blender's plan, but I sure hope they get these hotkeys together so I can move on with my life. Mouse still is malfunctioning. Oh my god. What is this? You know, fun fact, I have three of the same mouse on this desk. And now the latest version of that mouse is dead. The Razer. Oh, what's this mouse called? The Razer. Trinity. The Razer Trinity. Oh my god, I hate this mouse. I am so done with this. Anyways, for now, we'll wrap up this video because I need to go out and just get a regular mouse. I need hotkeys on my mouse, is the thing. And they offer that to me. So I'll press Alt-V and jump to EVHQ just to make sure that we're looking at this in its best light. And this video ended up going on quite long, at an hour and 16 minutes, I see. So we will wrap it up for now, and I'll save this file, and I'll see you guys next time.